This meeting was held in exciting Las Vegas, Nevada from July 9th through the 11th, 1999. This is videotape number 53.
It's called a cluster something. Yeah. Again, another technical term. Yeah, I'm real uncomfortable with this stuff that we got.
Hello.
Here.
Hello.
Yeah.
Uh-oh, it doesn't sound so hot.
Yeah, turn it down before we get in that. Please. Thanks. Get the mic over here. Yeah, I've got a mic. Let's hear it for goon ingenuity. Alright. Okay, first of all, I want to find out if, Professor Mann, do you have anything, some words that you want to say and start off with? And I guess you're going to be giving a lecture, or do you just want to go straight into taking questions?
I'm going to just give a lecture I'm going to give a sort of lecture to myself, and instead of seeing me, you're going to be being me.
Okay, great. And just an FYI, it looks like we've got the video here is frozen. So is that something on your end, or is that us? We have like a freeze frame here of you holding.
Could be getting 6 or 7 frames a second.
Okay, just a moment then. Let's try and solve that. Bear with us for just one moment, Professor. I heard of something called mediated reality as a buzzword in the media. Do you know anything about that, or have you heard, is that what you're involved with?
Mediated reality is something that's implemented with the EyeTap camera. Mediated reality means using the computer to alter the perception of reality.
I see. And what do you mean when you say alter the perception of reality?
Well, the EyeTap device absorbs light that would otherwise enter an eye of the wearer and modifies that light and then reconstructs that light to pass into the wearer's eye. So a simple example of mediated reality is when you're walking around, somebody wants to communicate with you. One way they can communicate is by altering your reality. For example, by putting a note on something, so you're walking along and you see a sort of message that is, or you might see, you go to the grocery store and you see the milk rolling to remind you to buy it, or you're talking to the used car salesman and, you know, your wife at home maybe makes his nose go long when she thinks he's lying.
Excellent. What if your wife's on acid at the time?
Well, you might have some problems there, but I think the general idea of mediated reality is to change the perception of reality. So it's a little bit different than virtual reality or video games in the sense that you still see as a baseline what is actually in the real world, and then you see that a modified version of that.
Again, I guess we're still trying to reestablish the video feed, and what I'd like to do, even though we would save this till the end, I was just going to take a few questions from some of the people in the crowd here, allow you to answer those, and then once we get the video feed going, then see what we're talking about here. So, let me see, how about you in front here? what type of irresponsible uses do you see for this type of technology, Professor?
I think like advertising, that type of thing. One of the things that I'm trying to do is design filters to filter out advertising so that when you're walking around, you can filter out real world spam. You know, already we have spam in the real world, such as billboards and things like that. So what I envision is that the mediated reality can be used to filter out the spam.
Excellent. Did you catch that, Professor?
No, I didn't hear that.
He asked, is the eye piece that you were speaking about, is that an implant? Is that an intrusive type of technology, or is it something that you simply wear?
The current embodiments of EyeTap technology, many of them are non-invasive, so that it's not necessary to modify the body in order to obtain an EyeTap.
I see. Take another question here. Anybody? Beck, the question was, can you describe any existing types of technology of this technology that are intrusive or invasive, I guess, as you put it?
I guess it depends on how invasive, whether things like electrodes and connections and things like that versus totally surface phenomena. The most useful technology, I believe now, is something that is totally a surface phenomenon, so that it doesn't have to involve any solid connection to the body that might be disruptive.
I see. That's what we got out there. This guy over here.
Yeah, the problem that I've always experienced when trying this use out is that it's interpreting the light, but it's actually taking the light and resourcing it. But there's like a 10 to 50 millisecond delay, so you turn your head and it takes reality to the 50 milliseconds to see it's answer.
Did you catch that, Professor?
Yeah, I guess there's the delay problem, and that's one of the reasons the early embodiments of the reality mediator, I did the processing off body, so I had I climbed up on the roof of the tallest building in the city and put the antennas there, and then I had a microwave downlink to the roof of the building that I was in, and then I ran it out from there into various computers, one of which was an SGI reality engine, and several other processors so that it could keep up with the processing rate. A big problem is processing rate and keeping up with the processing rate. So the other approach we're taking now is to build a Beowulf cluster with 64 processors in a kind of sort of clothing-based thing with 64 computers on it that you can wear underneath a shirt or something like that.
A wearable supercomputer?
Yeah, that's basically what it is. No, ordinarily, in my old rigs, I would be wearing 8 or 9 computers and fairly fast video processing engines. But I think the Beowulf cluster will be the right approach to getting enough compute power to really make the delay tolerable.
Okay, let me take somebody in the back here. There's a guy back here. The guy in the white shirt. The question was, can you describe the hardware you're wearing at the moment?
The hardware I'm wearing is a special purpose video processing engine, and then the host, the front end for it, is a Linux-based computer, simply running the Linux operating system, and communicating out of 100 base T tulip chip with the processing engine.
Just a moment before we continue. Just another update. Apparently, the guess is that somebody must have really wanted to see Jericho's talk because we're being smurfed from the outside. The DOS attack is coming from outside. So, yeah, it's a bummer. Unfortunately, we have some people with pretty juvenile attitudes, so that's what we're dealing with. So what we're going to do is, I guess, continue the Q&A until we can try to establish something, or until the DOS stops, and we're just going to keep working with it, so bear with us. There's a person in front who had one. You?
Yeah.
She said, what kind? kind of specific problems, anything? The question was, do you have problems with glass, mirrors, or other reflective surfaces?
Not particularly. The processing engine just processes the light that comes in, so mirror-like surfaces haven't particularly been a problem.
I see. But I genuinely be sure. The question was, what type of processors, and do you have a web page?
Yeah, the processors are described on the WearCam.org site, WearCam.org, which describes the kind of computers that are used. So there's a variety of different processors. The host is typically a Pentium-type processor. Some of the other ones, I'm using a Strongarm 1100 as the host processor, because that's got enough power to run Linux and XF86.
Can you repeat the URL? We've got some people with some pens that are kind of trying to get it written down.
Actually, when you get the video feed, I can show you. Is there a Linux box there or something that can pick this up? Because it was showing up earlier, I think, on a variety of Linux-based PCs or net BSD or just some kind of normal Unix box.
Yeah, we do have several boxes here. The problem is that we're getting a denial of service attack on our router or stream from us, and so we're not able to pass any traffic. And so that's what we're dealing with. We've only got internal connectivity at the moment. Let me take a couple more questions. The question was, what about using this equipment in telepresence environment?
Well, in many ways, this is telepresence.
The question was, when do you see this as a mass market commodity type of technology?
I think it's going to take a few years to mass produce this apparatus. So I see it maybe as a few years off before it becomes a commodity technology.
Okay. You back here? The question was, what is the status of PTP, the protocol you were using to transfer the images?
PTP is something that we're working on now, picture transfer protocol. So there's a good chance we may end up deciding to run that over IPv6, or we might, we're looking also doing some embodiments of UDP, and so we have a working embodiment of PTP, and so we're just experimenting on further developing the protocol and also the whole notion of
quickly, so we're going to try to restore your feed as soon as we can. We can take a few more questions here in the middle. What is the frame rate that you see, Professor?
The frame rate that I internally get is adjustable. I can choose to get a full frame rate on the order of 16 frames per second, or I can also select a frame rate. What I often do is I remotely log in to another computer and then set it back to me so that I can see a frame rate that would be typical of a computer somewhere else. So a lot of times if I'm giving a lecture, say in the UK somewhere, I'll remotely log into their computer and then bring it back so that I get a kind of delayed experience so that that enters into the feedback loop of how I give the presentation.
Is how much weight and how does this affect your range of movement, the equipment that you wear?
The major effect is, the equipment is much lighter now. 20 years ago, it was a very heavy apparatus back in the 1970s, weighing as much as I did. And now it's quite a bit lighter over the years. So I've built a number of them of different weights. I've built more than 100 different units and of very different weights. So some of them are quite lightweight and have lesser capabilities. A large Beowulf cluster, of course, you expect that to be heavier than, say, a simple video processing engine with a single computer as its host front end.
Professor, did you get that question?
No.
The question was, can you sort of enhance your senses, your vision, because you're mediating it, do things like binoculars or some kind of digital enhancement of your vision?
A couple of attributes of the current system. One is that I can see in total darkness because of the infrared capability of the EyeTap. Another interesting effect, of course, is that you see a lot of things that are happening over a broad band of frequencies, such as the elevator doors have all these sensors in them, and you can see where all the lights are, and I could read the numbers on the chips that were on the elevator door at the side. So I would often, at first when I was wearing the EyeTap, I would often look at the open elevator door and be reading the numbers on the chips and commenting on the resistor values, and other people would say, what are you talking about? I don't see anything. And then I took off my glasses and I realized I couldn't see anything except a black strip of plastic running down the side of the elevator, and I was seeing right through it because this was the device that was sensing whether or not the door was blocked, and there was some 42 LEDs and various circuit board running the whole length there. So you see a lot of things like that. The other thing, of course, is the Edgertonian vision that I would typically see, for example, the number of bolts on a wheel on a car that was going at 60 miles an hour. I could still count the bolts on the bolt circle and read the writing on the tires because of the sort of Edgertonian effect that the EyeTap can impart.
Very cool. Yeah, this guy promises to be another question here. Is there an implementation of your window manager that you spoke of earlier?
There are some prototypes of the video orbit. So, for example, now the video orbit is available on the WearCam.org site. The video orbit is
We just got your feed. We're getting your feed, and we're queuing down the lights. So we're seeing what you're seeing.
Oh, excellent! What sort of frame rate are you getting?
It looks like about 3 to 4 frames a second, or maybe between 2 and 4 frames a second.
Sometimes a little
faster.
Bit slow now, I guess. Is it?
Well, it's bursting. It's bursting sometimes, and then sometimes it's slowing down. I guess it probably depends on what kind of traffic we have out in the other room. see a hallway.
Good, good. All right, so this is the hallway at the University of Toronto, and then this is the section of the lab that I'm in here, so I'll just give you a little tour. We have a little area here with chairs, tables and chairs, where people can wait, and there is some various brochures here, some of them there's some brochures. Can you see what do you see now?
Windows NT. I guess you guessed. We love you, Professor. You've definitely got an everyone's cool book, I think.
And what we have is this series of papers and brochures, and there's the recycling bin here because we've got too much junk lying around, so I'll just put that in my recycling bin here.
Setting to do headset extras, extension 12-volt or higher, extension, personal cybernetics.
The title of my talk is Personal Cybernetics, and that's what I'm talking about here. And personal cybernetics is this notion of personal cybernetic technology, the combination of the WearComp invention and the EyeTap video camera. These two devices, when combined together, give you what I refer to as personal cybernetics. And personal cybernetics provides a kind of framework for like a personal extension of the mind and body. And the apparatus of the invention has evolved somewhat. This is a picture of one of the early sort of versions from years ago, a very cumbersome sort of EyeTap type or an eye connecting type device that involves a cathode ray tube. And throughout some degree of time error, there's some of these other ones involving cathode ray tubes, until more recently what I have is this kind of eyeglass based device with everything inside the glasses so that it just looks like ordinary eyeglasses and yet continues to provide an output of at least one eye of the wearer. So how is my video feed coming through?
It's looking excellent. I mean, it's the frame rate is, like I say, it's still between probably 2 and 5 frames a second, but it's pretty clear, and we've got a really nice projector here that's giving us a pretty good view. We had some questions or some requests that you, at some point, if you could stand in front of a mirror so that we can see what you look like, if it's possible.
Yeah, I guess I could do that. I've got some optics here in my lab, in my office. I've got a first surface mirror here, so you can probably see. This is I'm wearing now one of my older embodiments of my apparatus. Whereas I'll get a larger beam splitter. This is a big beam splitter that I've got here, and you can actually see through the beam splitter. But if I hold it around this way, it'll function sort of like a mirror, and you can kind of see. Can you see that?
Yeah, very clear, and it's very, very cool. Yeah, we see it perfectly.
So I use those beam splitters for making different optical systems so that I put a piece of glass into a bell jar and pump all the air out of the glass, and I have some electricity running through a piece of aluminum wire inside the glass, deposit a thin layer of aluminum, and then that makes a beam splitter, and of course a beam splitter
so occasionally you're getting some applause here, and you sort of cut out, but overall you're coming through pretty clear.
Good, good. So the other application that I'm looking at is filtering out spam in the real world. One of the problems that I noticed is that we've heard a lot lately about spam in email and getting spammed, but we've been spammed for years. We've been spammed by billboards and advertisements that are foisted upon us without our permission or consent, and we get spammed continuously with all this unwanted and unsolicited material. You're walking down the street and you see a big billboard, that's spam. So what I've been looking at is ways to filter out spam. Now, mainly spam has gotten a lot worse in recent years. This is a picture of some spam that's located on the wall directly above the urinal, and it's located in a place that's rather hard to ignore. The spam is difficult to ignore when it's located there. So this figure depicts the spam located here, and I've got my eyeglasses here. These are my newer glasses. People may have seen the newer ones, which look just like ordinary glasses, but they have this filtering out capability because of their glasses. This is what the spam looks like. This spam is located right here. It was in this building on the second floor for a little while, and what I've got here is, you can see there is the urinal here, and directly above it there is this picture of this woman wearing nothing but a bra, and what you have is this condom stuffed under one cup of the bra, which gives us a picture that may be distracting to the particular task at hand. The spam here has a caption under it pertaining to the word pleasure, and this is the company logo here and so on that we see within that spam. And so the way that the spam is dealt with is that the eyeglasses build an environment map which collects all the images together and makes this mathematical analysis using the Reality Window Manager. RWM is built upon this notion called video orbit, and video orbit is based on projective coordinate transformations in algebraic geometry, and video orbit assembles these images into this composite so that as I'm looking around they're joined together. And you can see here that the spam is here, and the entire scene has been pieced together mathematically. Now once it's in that mathematical form, then the spam can be replaced with other material. So here is the image where the spam has been filtered out. So what I've done here is replace the spam. orbits our gaze pattern. Here I'm talking to the department store representative, and I look up here towards the ceiling, and I look around this way, and it captures the surveillance infrastructure on the ceiling, and it's part of the ShootingBack project. The other project that we're researching here is a project called Please Wait. Please Wait is a project that involves a head-mounted display that covers completely the face of the wearer. Can everybody see that?
Yeah,
we're able to see that.
So I have here a head-mounted display that covers the wearer's eyes and ears so that I can't hear anything or see anything until there is some interaction. There's a keypad here, and there's a card reader with a slot on it, and this is the camera here, and it's integrated into a larger system. I have here a front view of the apparatus of this invention, and there is a short antenna for transmitting video, and there is a long antenna for receiving video, and there is also this antenna sticking out of the backpack, which contains the computer, and we're running TCP/IP over the radio and sending data back and forth and so on. So what we have here is this keypad, and there's a little set of instructions underneath the keypad.
just a second, Professor. I'm going to get the lights keyed up. We've got a number of questions, and I'm going to get the lights keyed up a little bit so I can see. That's enough. We still want to be able to see your display here. Okay, where should I start here? Who have I not called on? You. What do you do for power, Professor?
Well, I'm working with some various companies of batteries. I've got a company in France that makes the cells for me, and then I have a systems integrator in the U.S. that brings them into configuration, series parallel combinations distributed around the body, and so it's a big research area to keep a large number of computers operational all the time, because I like uptime, typically it's 16 hours a day rather than the 2 hours a day that you get from an ordinary laptop.
Let me let a couple other people ask some questions. Let's see, you have asked me. Is there any kind of physiological repercussion of wearing your equipment?
I've been sort of developing this for about 20 years now, and there were some problems that I had with some of the earlier units, but lately I've come up with some innovations that allow an EyeTap to function without doing damage. EyeTap is a lot different than a display. Display devices do result in eye damage and eye strain. So for example, if you take a traditional wearable computer type display, like a wearable TV, type display, like you see that there are existing head mounted displays that you can buy on the market, and those do have adverse effects, I find. And so a main reason for doing EyeTap technology is to avoid some of the problems that arise with head mounted display technology.
Excellent. Professor, we've got time for about four more questions, so I'm gonna take four more, and we've got another speaker coming on, and I don't want to. Let's see, you indicated the team.
For being on the cutting edge of technology, you use a lot of paper. Why don't you, since you don't wear anything to your doctor, just like you can have a little bit.
You said, did you catch that, Professor?
I heard a little bit of it.
He was wondering why aren't you using more digital media to communicate your ideas rather than scribbling on paper?
I guess because I'm a Luddite. You see, I don't like a lot of modern technology. I think we're moving into a very unhumanizing world where technology is dehumanizing us in so many ways. You know, things like surveillance cameras and computers everywhere, and ubiquitous computing and ubiquitous surveillance. I'm really trying to call into question some of this technology. So you might say that I'm trying to tame the monster with a little piece of itself. And I'm really trying to get back to basics. I really like the tactile feel of paper, and I like the pen, the way it slides across the paper, and I like using chalkboards, and I like the way the chalk feels on the chalkboard, and the tactility of it, and the dust, and the reality of it. I love reality. And in many ways, when one uses VGA as an output medium, in the traditional sense of sort of PowerPoint running on top of virus of some kind, you're losing touch in many ways with the sort of beauty of the real world.
Just a second, Professor. Speaking of viruses, I've got a virus scan coming, covering your feed, so just a moment, I'm going to rectify that and take two more questions. Has lost all touch with reality, so it's not coming back. We're catching like a fourth of your feed. We've got a window covering your feed, so I'm going to get two more questions, and then we're going to have to wind down. Just a moment. I've already taken some of your questions. If somebody who hasn't asked some, you. That question's already been asked. You.
Yeah,
that's a good question. What are the costs involved in, for example, what you have on, or what can you tell us about the cost of your projects?
Initially, the cost is very, very, very high. So building the first prototype costs a tremendous amount. So there is a great deal of cost involved. However, my hope is to, in terms of manufacturing, to be able to get the manufacturing costs down. And I'm looking at getting my invention manufactured in a large scale at a low cost so that people will be able to afford this, because it will be no good if only the big can afford it. That is to say, if only large organizations and the military industrial can afford it. You know, it's turned into a yes sir type of technology. I think what we really need is to bring the cost down so it turns into more like a Walkman type of technology.
Okay. I'm gonna take, actually I have two guys here who have been holding their hands up a while. I'm gonna take this guy first. Can you show us any of the effects real quick, or some of the things you were speaking about earlier?
I guess if it's something IR, it's quite similar. The other, it's a different eyetap that I normally wear for IR, and that particular eyetap that sees in the IR is very much a kind of eyetap that only sees black and white and doesn't have color, so that eyetap doesn't have this beautiful 24-bit color, but on the other hand, it has that infrared, and I guess things like camcorder remotes, I'm just looking to see if I've got one here, but maybe what I should do really is get the other eyetap on at some point in time.
We'd love to have you back next year and show us what you're up to. So that would be a great opportunity for you to do that. Let me take another question here. You should. He's already addressed that. Unless somebody else. You. He's already addressed that. Somebody else. You. He's already addressed that. Somebody else. How about, I got a question for you, Professor. I think I'm entitled to one since I've been announcing here. What inspired you to get involved in this type of thing? What were your what kind of background did you have in this? Why did you do this in the first place?
Well, I guess my interest was in creating personal space. I was a little bit disturbed by the way technology was going, and I didn't really like what I saw in terms of technology, and I decided, I guess, to create my own personal space. And the other motivation was kind of photographic in nature. I've always been fascinated by light and photography, and I wanted to become a camera, sort of being a camera as a very existential principle of self-determination and mastery over one's own destiny. So it's kind of a long long story that I'll have to write one day.
Excellent. Well, I want to thank you for joining us. It's been very fun. We've got a full house here. Give him a hand. That just kicked ass, I've got to say. Right on. Thanks a lot.